Okay, so thanks a lot for the invitation. Don't hesitate to interrupt. This will be a synthesis of some evidence, some work to which I have contributed, and some others to which I haven't contributed. As you may know, emission trading is a very controversial issue, with some people really opposed. Some people, especially some economists, defending it. But I think some of these opinions are not really based on evidence. And now we have the evidence basis to so that people will still not be will still disagree at the end. But maybe they will disagree for better reasons than without looking at the evidence. So I send you one paper, which is really a synthesis, but really short, and I will refer to other works and give you some references at the end. So where does this EU ETS is an acronym for emission, for European Union Emission Trading Scheme or Emission Trading System. So emission trading didn't start in order to tackle climate change, but it's relatively recent policy tool compared to other environmental policies. Before the 1990s, environmental policies mostly consisted in various kinds of regulations, some subsidies to help industries reduce polluting emissions, and what's called earmarked taxes, that is taxes that were not primarily aiming at reducing emissions by making emissions more expensive, but rather they aimed at raising money in order to fund the subsidies that I just mentioned. And these policies were criticized by some economists on the ground that they were not cost efficient. That they didn't allow to reduce emissions at the lowest cost. I'll develop this point later. All these environmental policies were invented, so to speak, by policymakers and not by academics. It's different for emission trading. It's really an economist's idea. Maybe it's why many economists defend it. And more precisely, by an American and a Canadian scholar, one proposed to apply it to air pollution mitigation and the other to water pollution. It was not, of course, applied immediately. The first applications were really limited in scope. They took place in the US to reduce air pollution, more concretely. Since the early 70s, the Environmental Protection Agency in the US set emission limits for primarily for big power plants, for example, for particulate or SO2. And in the mid 70s, the EPA started to allow some plants to emit below their emission limits. In exchange, they had to fund emission reduction somewhere else. It's called offsets. But it was really limited, and the first full-scale implementation took place also in the US, also to tackle air pollution. But it was in 1995 that a national market for SO2 permits or SO2 allowances started. And so it covers mostly power plants, but also some other big plants. And and so every operator of these plants has an emission cap. So it's expressed in tons of SO2. It receives some freely some allowances for this cap, and this operator can emit SO2 above this cap. Only by buying allowances from other participants who do better than their emission cap. This is generally considered as a success, even though in recent years this system has in fact stopped, does not have any impact at all for an interesting reason. In fact, this system was implemented in order to reduce the acid rain problem. And after its implementation, it appeared that the cost of reducing emissions was much lower than expected. And it could be measured by the price of emission allowances on the market. So the cost was lower than expected, and benefits appeared to be higher than expected because the health impact of SO2 was previously under-evaluated. And so, what did the EPA do when they realized that the benefits were higher than expected and the cost lower than expected? They decided to set a more stringent emission cap to reduce the total quantity of SO2 emitted. Unfortunately, this takes place in the US, and some courts ruled that the EPA does not have the authority to fix the cap, and that just a law could do it, and there was not the political opportunity to pass such a law. So what did the EPA do? They did what they did before, emission trading. They set stringent emission caps for power plants, and so there is no demand anymore for these allowances, and the price has collapsed to zero. So this system, which was a kind of benchmark and really a model for emission trading, it exists on paper, but it has no impact anymore. This was so not for greenhouse gases, but for air pollution. I think here I have to briefly summarize what happened with the international negotiation on climate change. So this negotiation took place, started in the late 80s by some discussion at the UN and G8, or G7 at that time, probably. They decided to set up the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, which issues a synthesis report every 6 or 7 years about the climate science. And it led to the adoption of a United Nations Convention, the UN Framework Convention on Climate Change. In 1992, it was in Rio. And this convention entered into force in 1994. And it's an important text. It sets general principles, but it does not include concrete targets. And so it was clear from the beginning that there was a need for some more, for a new treaty. And this second treaty is the Kyoto Protocol, which was adopted in 1997, which set emission limits for industrialized countries. I'll precise later what this means. Unfortunately, so you see that the first 10 years of these negotiator sessions were really productive, really fast, given the problem at stake. Unfortunately, it went much slowly afterwards, especially because the United States decided not to ratify Kyoto. In spite of this refusal by the US, the protocol entered into force in 2005, and it set emissions for the emission caps for countries for the period 2008 to 12. So, of course, very soon started the negotiation for what to do afterwards. There was a hope that this would be negotiated in Copenhagen in 2009. As you may remind, it failed. And so the next conference, you know when and where it is. I don't have to tell you that, but what expected is some kind of commitments that will be much weaker than the commitments in the Kyoto Protocol. So what is in the Kyoto Protocol? Mostly emission caps for industrialized countries with some flexibility mechanisms that I will present in more detail. Importantly, the protocol does not oblige its parties, countries which have ratified, to set up a domestic emission trading system, that is an emission trading system covering its polluting plants. Countries are free to choose the policies they want to respect their emission cap according to the Kyoto Protocol. The rest I will not I don't have to mention further. So on this map, you see the different types of countries in the according to the Kyoto Protocol. In blue, it's the countries what are called Annex B countries or Annex 1 countries, that is industrialized countries according to the Kyoto Protocol, that is countries with an emission cap. And in yellow, you have the countries which have either never ratified, the US, or have ratified and then withdrawn, that is Canada. And in green, you have all the countries without an emission target, because at that time they were considered as non-industrialized countries. And of course, now they emit the vast majority of greenhouse gases worldwide, China being the first emitter. And so, it's in this context of the Kyoto Protocol that some emission trading systems appeared for greenhouse gases. And here you have in green the emission trading systems that currently exist. The first one by the volume of gases covered is the European Union one. But you have also several systems in the US, one in California, and one REGI covering the northeastern states of the US. You have one in Quebec with a link with the Californian system, that is the allowances emitted in Quebec can be used in California. You will soon have others in other US states and Canadian provinces. And you have also, very importantly, seven pilot systems in China, which started in 2013 or 14. And China has announced a national emission trading system in 2017. So you see that there are other projects in other countries, but you see that it's a policy tool which will be used more and more in the next future. So the most important thing in the Kyoto Protocol is the emission caps for industrialized countries. The second important thing is the so-called flexibility mechanisms. There are four of them. First one is just that some countries can ratify together and share their emission rights. It was done in the EU. I will not comment it further. The second one is emission trading among industrialized countries. For example, Japan can emit above its limit and buy allowances from Russia if Russia emits below its limit. So it's really the idea of emission trading as it was applied in the US for SO2, but applied to countries and not to firms. The last two mechanisms are based on projects. Joint implementation takes place between two industrialized countries. For example, Gaz de France can think that it's cheaper to reduce emissions in Russia because there are cheap ways to do it. For example, gas pipelines are leaking. And so if Gaz de France can pay for a project reducing emissions in Russia, and if it's approved by various institutions, it receives credits according to an estimation of the non-emitted greenhouse gases in Russia. So this is among two Annex 1 countries, and the clean development mechanism is the same kind of mechanism, but with the project taking place in a developing country, so a country without a cap. And this raises the difficult problem of what's called additionality, that is, the number of emission credits generated by a CDM project is proportional to an estimation of the non-emitted greenhouse gases thanks to this project. But it's just an estimation, and all parties have an interest in lying, in pretending that more emission is abated than what will really take place. And since you cannot observe the counterfactual, you cannot observe what would have taken place without the CDM project, it's extremely difficult to have an idea. For example, do you know what's the number one country for wind energy in the world?
Denmark.
It was Denmark many years ago. In share of electricity production is Denmark, yes. 40%. But in absolute value? China, yes. Somebody said so. So almost China is by far the number one by the wind energy produced now, or capacity. And almost every wind mill in China was subsidized through the clean development mechanism. Most of them, of these projects, would have taken place anyway, without the CDM. So it's typically a case of non-additionality. And the problem is that this increases the emissions that countries with a Kyoto target can are allowed to do. So the UETS was created on this background. And we can say that, somebody said that it's a consequence of two failures by the European Union. The first failure was that in Kyoto, in the Kyoto negotiation, the EU was against emission trading. Emission trading was defended by the US and some other countries. But the EU wanted caps without flexibility, without trading. But in order to get the acceptance of the of targets by the US, the EU has to agree for targets with emission trading. Otherwise, there would have been no Kyoto protocol with emission caps. The second failure was that the European Commission, as soon as the early 90s, proposed an energy tax, energy carbon tax, in the EU. And it failed. It was rejected by member states for several reasons. One reason was that for fiscality, decisions in the EU are made, require the unanimity of member states. And it's, of course, very difficult to have unanimity. And another reason was that there was a heavy lobbying by heavy industry because the heavy industry feared that it would lose competitiveness compared to the rest of the world if there was an energy tax, carbon energy tax in the EU. And there were also some stupid debate between France and other countries about whether energy or carbon emissions or both should be taxed. So there could be no emission tax. And so the Commission proposed an emission trading system because this is considered as an environmental policy. And so decisions for environmental policies are not taken, do not require unanimity, but just qualified majority of member states with a co-decision by the parliament. So it's much easier to get an approval for an emission trading system than for a tax, which is stupid because it's really similar policy tools, but it's a reality. So the Commission proposed a directive in 2001. It was adopted 2 years later, and it started operating 2 other years later. So, The Commission at the beginning wanted an emission tax. Finally, we have an emission trading system. What's the main difference between these two policies? There are, of course, several differences, but I think the most important one is the way they react to uncertainty. And we will see how it did in the rest of my presentation. So the choice between an instrument which sets a price, such as a tax or a subsidy, and a policy instrument which sets a quantity, such as, for in this case, an emission trading system, was analyzed by Martin Weitzman in a famous article in 1974. I don't know if some of you have heard of this article. Yes? How many? Just to have an idea. Okay, you're in minority. So here is how Martin Weitzman frames the problem. I have to precise that he was not interested in climate change. It's a much more general paper. He's interested how to produce a public good. Public good in this case is climate change mitigation, so less greenhouse gas emissions. So, on this graph, I represent on the x-axis the CO2 emissions aggregated over many emitters. And this line is the marginal abatement cost curve. So, it represents how it costs in euros per ton of CO2 to reduce emissions by an additional ton. So, without any policy, emissions would take place at this point. And for a very small CO2 price, emissions would be reduced up to this point, and so on and so on. Of course, it's upward sloping if you reduce emissions, because you start by the cheapest options, and then you have to move to more expensive options. Okay? if you accept, just for the sake of reasoning, that we can put a monetary value on the damages from climate change, which is extremely difficult, and I think it's most of the figures that circulate are really extremely fragile, but just imagine that we can put a monetary value on this. So the marginal cost of pollution, so the cost of adding an extra unit of CO2 in the atmosphere, is the same as the cost of reducing emissions by one unit. Okay, so it's also the marginal benefit from abatement. Abatement means emission reduction. Okay, and this is this curve. Here it's represented with an upward slope. Does not have to, but let's do it like that. So, if you agree that you can put a cost on pollution, then the optimal level of pollution is given by this intersection. Okay? Because if you emit more than this point, the benefit from abatement is higher than the cost, so you should emit less. If you are on the left, the cost of abatement is higher than the benefit. The marginal cost is higher than the marginal benefit, so you should emit more. So you end up on this point. This is if you know precisely the position and the shape of these curves. Okay? And in such a case, if you know these curves, it would make no difference to set a tax or to set a quota, that is an emission trading system, with some additional assumptions I don't develop on this point. Why? Because if you set up a tax at this point, firms will abate up to this point, because if they emit more, it's not rational, because it costs more to pay the tax than to abate, and they don't go further, because below this point for emissions, it's more costly to reduce emissions further than to pay the tax. Okay. And alternatively, the other solution for the policymaker is to set an emission cap at this point. And so the CO2 price on the market will be the same as the tax. Of course, this is very theoretical, but this is especially without uncertainty, in order to focus on the impact of uncertainty. Is this clear? Very okay. It starts to be interesting if the marginal abatement cost curve is not as expected. Imagine, for example, that the marginal abatement cost curve is on the left, meaning that emissions without a public policy would be lower. This would be the case, for example, in case of an economic recession, because some plants close, don't, so you have less emissions. And imagine that the slope stays the same. It's not very important here. So what happens in this case? The two policies, these two alternative policies, behave in opposite manners. First, the real optimum, the ex post optimum, if you know this information, is here. So it's optimal to emit less than what you thought based on the wrong assumption about the marginal abatement cost curve, okay? And also, the optimal CO2 price ex post is lower than expected. So what happens if you set an emission cap? Emissions are, as long as the cap is binding, that is, as long as the cap is more stringent than emissions without a public policy, the emission level stays the same, but the CO2 price is lower. See? So it's a quantitative instrument, so the authorities set a quantity, and the market, market participants, their interaction, produce the price. Of course, it would be the opposite with the marginal abatement cost on the right of its expected value. So, and what happens with the tax? With the tax, it's a price instrument. So the tax level is known in advance. What is unknown is the level of emissions. And in this case, emissions would be lower than what they would be for the emission trading system, and also lower than the optimum. And the CO2 price, I've said so. So to sum up, with ETS, emissions are too high and the CO2 price too low, in case when the marginal abatement cost curve is lower than expected. And with the tax, it's the opposite. Okay? And if the cap marginal abatement cost curve is higher than expected, it's just the outcome is purely symmetric. You see that in this figure, the slope of the marginal abatement cost curve in absolute value is higher than the slope of the marginal abatement benefit curve. And this is, in fact, important to know what is the best instrument. You see that whether you look at prices or at quantities, here, the tax is closer to the exposed optimum than the emission trading system. And at the limit, if the marginal abatement benefit had been completely flat, that is the same external cost for an extra unit of emissions, then the tax would be exposed optimal. Because in this case, you know in advance the marginal abatement benefit, so you just have to set the tax at the marginal abatement benefit, and you are always at the optimum. Vice versa, if the marginal abatement benefit is purely vertical, this can happen if you have an electrological threshold, for example. If you know that you don't, if you emit too much, and if you know this limit, there will be a complete change in your ecosystem. In some cases, this happens. Then you have to put a cap below this emission limit in order to be sure that you will never reach it. If you are somewhere in between, as in this on this graph, Martin Weitzman demonstrate is that the best instrument, in the one which generates the higher expected welfare, is a price instrument if the marginal abatement benefit is flatter than the marginal abatement cost, as on this graph, and vice versa. Okay. So this is the conclusion from Weitzman's paper. And what's the answer for climate change? There's been several applications of this framework for climate change. Of course, it's much more complex than this graph because it's a stock pollutant with a dynamic nature. But still, all the estimation I've seen conclude that the marginal abatement benefit for climate change is almost flat. So a price instrument is better than a quantity instrument. And it's bad news if you remind that the European Commission has failed, or the European Union has failed to adopt a tax and has ended up adopting a quantity instrument, an emission trading system. In addition, there are other arguments for the tax and compared to the ETS, which especially the possibility of market power on the emission trading market. The transaction cost and also questions related to frauds. So, unfortunately, we don't have what most economists consider as the best instrument. So, more precisely, what are the main characteristics of this of the European Union emission trading system? I don't know if you can read it it's too small, sorry. But I just focus on the most important thing. We are in the third trading period. The first period lasted 3 years, from 2005 to 2007. So this was before the Kyoto Protocol commitment period. It was a kind of pilot phase. The second period of the EU ETS lasted during the first commitment period of the Kyoto Protocol. 2008 to 12, and we are in the third period, which started in 2013 and lasted until 2020. And currently, a fourth period is negotiated that will start in 2021 and end up in 2030, probably. One of the most important things is that in the first two periods, the member states defined the number of quotas, the number of allowances, both the aggregate number of allowances in their country, but also how many allowances any emitter would receive. There are about 10,000 plants covered by the ETS now. What's important also is that this system covers electricity production and heavy industry, and now aviation. So it does not cover agriculture, it does not cover direct emission by households for heating or for transportation. And from the third period, allocation is done by the EU based on a common formula. So what happened for this market? This is the evolution of the price of allowances in blue here from the beginning of the system up to today. It's expressed in euro per ton of CO2 equivalent. And you see a very erratic evolution of the price. In fact, what happened was that in the first period, in the first 2 years, price was higher than expected at around 20, 25 euros a ton of CO2. And then suddenly, the price crashed up to about 10 euros per ton of CO2. So what happened? What happened was that in, I think it was in April 2006, the European Commission published the emissions data for the previous year, for 2005, the first year of operation. And then people were surprised that emissions were lower than expected and lower than the quantity of allowances that were allocated. So there was a surplus of allowances. There was a first surplus. So it's if you present it in this language, in the language of this model, what happened was that emissions were exaggerated by market participants. And so when they knew not all this curve, but when they received information about the level of emissions, they realized that this curve was on the left. And the CO2 price went down a lot. So this happened in April 2006. Then in April 2007 was published the level of emissions in 2006. It was again below the quantity of allowances allocated. So the price went down and down to zero. Zero because you couldn't use allowances issued for the first period in the next periods. It was a rule. And so these allowances for the first period were completely worthless at the end of 2007. Just nobody would have an interest in buying them. Okay? But for the second period, then the European Commission had learned, and it had forced the member states to give less allowances. And so there was a scarcity, a real scarcity of allowances in 2008. And so the price again went up to 25 euros a ton, approximately. So what happened then? You can probably guess what happened. It was in 2009. Yes, the economic recession. And the economic recession hit particularly all the building material industry, cement, glass, tiles, and so on, which are covered by the ETS. So less production means less emissions, so less demand for allowances. And so the price went down. It did not went down to zero this time because allowances distributed for the second period can be used for the third period and the fourth period and so on. It's called banking. And so people think that these allowances will be useful at least someday. But still, from 30 euros, the price was down to 3 euros. Now it recovers a bit. It's around 8 or 9 euros. So you see very erratic movements, which are not incidental. I think it happens on every emission trading system. And it's really a feature of a pure quantity instrument. In a world when there is necessarily some uncertainty, nobody could knew that a crisis would happen in 2009. Many people said that there would be a recession, but we just couldn't know when and it would happen and what it would look like. And so it's just normal that it's just a feature of a quantity instrument that the price fluctuates like this. This being said, the surplus, especially in the first period, was due to the fact that some countries were especially generous in the quantity of allowances they gave to the industry. So on this graph, you have from 2005 to 2012, so the period in which member states decided the quantity of allowances, with some control of the European Commission at the end, but not much. The dotted line here is for the EU ETS as a whole. And the y-axis, it gives you the percentage of oversupply, that is, allocation minus emissions in percentage of emissions. Okay? So if you are above the 0% line, it means that this country, for this year, has given more allocation than the emissions, and vice versa, if you are below the line. Okay? You see that France for the, is the only big country which, for these 8 years, has consistently given more allowances than the emissions. France was extremely generous with its industry. Whereas, for example, the United Kingdom, in the first 3 years, was really stringent with its industry. What explains these different behaviors? It's really a question of lobbying of in the different countries. I've said that there was over-allocation, in fact, every year except 2008, where, if you look at the dotted line, we are above 0%, while it's a draw for 2007, but it's below the line only in 2008. But you could say, okay, emissions are lower than allocation because there was some abatement, thanks to the CO2 price. Don't forget, the aim of the system is to reduce emissions. So in fact, and it's partly true, it seems. There's not so many estimations of the quantity of emissions reduced thanks to the EU ETS, which is surprising because it's the very aim of this policy. But the estimations give a range of somewhere between 2 and 4% of emissions. So how do people perform these estimations? Most of this abatement took place in the electricity sector, which is more than half of the emissions covered. They use typically a model of the electricity market. On the electricity market, you have several kinds of power plants. Some plants have a very low marginal cost, like nuclear or renewables. They have a high investment cost, but a very low variable cost, so they produce whenever they can. And it's represented here on this graph, where you have the power on the x-axis and the marginal cost on the y-axis. And then you have fossil fuel plants, some coal in light gray, coal plants, gas plants in dark gray, and oil plants in black. Without CO2 price, in general, coal plants have a lower marginal cost, because coal is much cheaper than gas. And then it's gas, and oil is just for peak demand. But if you add, as in this model, if you add a CO2 price, then you see that some gas power plants have a lower marginal cost than some coal power plants. So what happens is that operators, electricity producers, they shut down some coal power plants and use more their gas power plants when there is a CO2 price. Of course, it depends on the relative price of gas and coal, which changes every day, but this is the main channel through which a CO2 price reduces emissions in the short run. And based on these estimations, it seems that there was a few percent emission reductions thanks to the ETS. And this, around 3% maybe, of emissions, is roughly the over-allocation in the first period. So it implies that, ex post, we can say that the cap was set at the level, approximately at the level of emissions, which would have taken place without the CO2 price. So still in the language of my graph before, the cap was approximately like this, approximately at the level of emissions that would have taken place without the CO2 price. But this is easy to say afterwards, of course. I just can't help telling this story about France, because I've shown you that France was very generous. So I think it's interesting to see how they presented the decisions they made regarding the number of allowances. Because they said, at that time, the French government said, we have an ambitious plan, we will reduce emissions by 2.43%. But what does it mean? In fact, there was a debate between the ministry in charge of environment and the ministry in charge of industry, as usual. And guess who won? The ministry in charge of industry. So, on this graph, I did the following. I took the observed emissions from 1990 to 2002, and I did it when this was negotiated. And I just plot a linear trend up to the first period of the ETS. So the trend was a decrease in emissions by 0.5% yearly, in average. And then the government scenario, what did they do? The government did a scenario, and they said, this is the business as usual scenario, an increase by 3.6% a year in emissions from 2002 to the first period of the ETS. And the minus 2.43%, it's compared to this counterfactual scenario, which they call business as usual, but clearly it's not a prolongation of the previous trend. And what's the difference between the linear trend and the cap? It's 15%. And what was the overall allocation in France in the first period? 15%. Okay, so I've said that there was not much estimation of the abatement due to the ETS in the except in the electricity sector. In the other sectors, in steel, we see no impact. If you look at the emissions here in blue, the emissions per ton of steel, it was reduced before the implementation of the ETS, but not after, so no impact at all. In cement, with a colleague, we estimated the evolution of emissions and in order to assess the impact of the ETS. What happened was, don't look at the left, but just on the right. We estimate the reduction in emission due to ETS at 1 to 3% of emissions, mostly in Germany and the UK, and mostly due to a change in the fuels used in cement plants. And so, I think I have to hurry up a bit. I move to one controversial issue, which was called the profits, that is the profits made by industry covered by the ETS. There are two kinds of these profits, windfall profits and overall allocation profits. The windfall profits can be explained like this. Allowances were given for free at that time, but they can be sold, so they have an opportunity cost. And in the power sector, in the markets which are not regulated, when the price of electricity is free, what happened was that the cost of the allowances was passed on to the consumers, even though allowances were given for free. And of course, this led to heavy criticisms, but it's just a normal behavior. If you take a standard model with profit maximizing firms, they do that. But on equity grounds, of course, it's a cash transfer from the consumer of electricity to the shareholders of power generation firms. So this led to a fierce debate. What happened was that from the third period onward, electricity generators have to buy their allowances. They don't receive free allowances anymore. And it's not little numbers. If you multiply the quantity of allowances by the price at the beginning of the system, you end up with 40 billion a year, which is about one third of the EU budget. There's more and more evidence that there has been windfall profits also in other sectors, like iron and steel. But still, these companies have managed to avoid paying their allowances, arguing that if they have to pay for allowances, they will close some plants, and steel or cement will be imported. And so there will be job losses in Europe and an increase in emissions in the rest of the world, which is called carbon leakage. And for this reason, especially iron and steel has received much more allowances than when they need, whereas combustion, which is mostly electricity, has received, as soon as the second period, less allowances than their emissions, and then they have to buy almost everything. So I move to the current debate, which is how to make the price of allowances rise and how to deal with the surplus in the excess in allowances. So now there is a surplus of allowances. I mean, there is in circulation unused allowances representing more than 1 year of emissions. It's due to several factors, the economic recession, the use of the Kyoto credits, CDM, Clean Development Mechanism, and Joint Implementation that I've presented at the beginning, because firms covered by the ETS can use the credits, the Kyoto credits, to cover their emissions. It's also due to the other policies, especially the promotion of renewables, because more renewables means less emissions from fossil fuel plants, which means less emissions and so less demand for allowances. This explains this trend. And when some people argue that it's not a problem because the emission cap will go down, hopefully up to nearly zero in the middle of the century. Here, the histogram gives you the emissions, and the bars give you the caps of the various periods of the ETS. So you see that up to now, the cap is almost every year higher than the emissions, but hopefully it will not be the case in the future. But still, the Commission has adopted some proposal to reduce the surplus, especially what's called the market stability reserve, which will soon be adopted. And it works like that. If the surplus is above a threshold, a part of the surplus is put in the reserve every year. Vice versa, this is this threshold, 833 million tonnes. We are at more than 2,000 now. If the surplus is too low, some allowances will be put out of the reserves and put on the market. So it's a kind of hybrid regulation. And this is the official projection by the Commission. Here you have the surplus. Now it reaches 1 year of emissions. The idea is that the market stability reserve will start operating in 2019, that progressively the surplus will be transferred to the reserve. But you see that even in the official Commission document, the surplus will end up only in 2030. So we will, it's a very modest proposal to reduce the problem. So I conclude. So what can we say? There has been some achievement. A few percent of abatement due to the ETS, but massive problems, over allocation and a too low CO2 price
and a high price volatility, plus massive windfall profits, at least in the electricity sector, it was only partly corrected. With that, the recession overallocation would have been corrected, but the recession is here. price volatility, it's not corrected. And windfall profit is corrected in electricity because now they have to pay for their allowances, but not in the rest of the covered industry. There are some more debates going on. What will they do with the allowances that are in the market stability reserve at the end? I argue, and with others, for a price floor, that is a minimum price for solid selling allowances, so that the ETS would more look like a tax. There is debate, another heavy debate is, should we include more sectors, like public transportation, private transportation, for example? Another debate that will go on is, should we link this system to other emission trading systems in the world, like the one in California or maybe in China? So here are the key references. this book is the main reference for the first period, but it's really pro-emission trading. this is a small state of the art by the European Commission. And this article by German colleagues gives a good overview of the debates and of the proposals. And this UK report is a synthesis of all expert studies about the ETS. It's very useful too. This NGO, Sandbag, produces very useful analysis based on quantitative data about the ETS. And the World Bank provides every year a report about carbon pricing, including emission trading, worldwide. Thank you for all your attention.
We will try to summarize the paper, and me and Gabriele, we will go through the paper, but first I will cover the EU ETS system, then I will do the summary of the paper, and then Gabriele, she will go to the theoretical framework, and we will try even to connect this topic with the COP21, and then we will have some time for some questions and critics. So we will start with the ETS, and basically in this moment is the most important regulation in Europe in terms of environmental issue, and basically is a quantity system based on trying to limit the number of emission in the European Union. On all the European Union plus Iceland, Liechtenstein and Norway. It covers around the 45% of the EU greenhouse emission. And I will leave to the how to begin because it already has been explained. But I will cover now the phases. So basically we had three phases. And the first one is going to the first phase one, started in 2005 to 2008. And here we face a kind of failure because the prices fall to zero, basically, the prices of allowances. The second phase is, it was between 2008-2012, face a surplus of allowances due to the crisis. So also in this case, the prices are full. And now we are in the middle of the phase three with a reduction in which the policy is to reduce the cap of allowances every year by 1.74%. And now we'll move to the how does it work, the ETS. Basically, the European Union with this system every year set a cap, a maximum amount of emission that companies can produce and pollute. It doesn't mean that companies cannot produce any longer and they cannot pollute. They can do it, but not above the cap. And in order to permit companies to produce, the European Union set and fix provide a fixed number of European emission allowances. In this way, they determine the maximum amount of allowances per year. And companies cannot go above this cap, otherwise they will face fines from the European Union. So, let's go. And So in this framework, companies can do mainly three things. First, they can pollute as long as they not surpass the cap. Then, with these allowances, basically there is behind a market. And with this, in this market, it can happen that companies can produce over the cap or below the cap. But the main point is that one company that can save allowances and then sell to other companies, and this second company can produce over the cap. But still, the maximum amount remain the same and below the cap. And the third thing is that if one company in 1 year will not produce all and will not go over the cap, can save these allowances for the next years, and in next years going over the cap and produce over and pollute even more. So in this moment, we are, as I said, in the third phase. And the idea from the European Commission is to reduce the cap every year by 1.74%. But actually, the European Commission is saying that if they want to reach the reduction by minus 0.40% compared to the 1990 levels, they should reduce even more every year, and not by 1.74%, but by 2.2%. And
starting in 2021,
this reduction. And then to reach the main target in 2050 and trying to reduce the emission by the 80-95%. Now I will try to summarize the paper. I will not try to repeat the same arguments and the same topic that you said, but just to say that the main argument from this paper, as while I was reading this paper, is that this system, DTS, did not work not only for its theoretical framework behind, not only because it's a quanti system, but because there is in some way, political reason behind that lead to companies that are not going to invest in the long run and not in innovation, but they have only a short run point of view. And so the best response will be either a carbon tax or a control over the carbon price. So in this point of view, the first, as I said, the first point is that companies, they are not, they are only looking in the short term point of view. They are not going to invest in innovation, and this is the first point. But one other point, I think, is the crisis system and the main important role of the crisis, because as Professor Quirion said, with the fall of the industrial production due to the crisis, companies did not produce any longer as before. They did not reach the cap, so the production remained below, and they had a surplus of allowances. With this surplus of allowances, the quantity of these certificates remain the increase, and the price decrease. So basically, in 2008, the prices of allowances were 25 euro. Today is 5 euro. And another point is the allocation effect, because since the beginning, there is a too large initial allocation that doesn't create an incentive for companies to decrease the pollution. So here another point is that related with the ability to compete in the market by companies. And what is the reality? Actually, many companies, they move in places in which they could produce without any restriction. But even the point in which the European Commission consider a sector at risk. In the moment in which the European Commission consider a sector at risk, they were giving to these companies 100% free allowances. In this way, in the first moment, so in phase one, there were only 29 sectors above 258. They were receiving free allowances. But in phase three, so in the phase in which we are now, there are 146 companies out of 258, so more than half, that are receiving free allowances. And in this way, and you already mentioned this this point, there is an unfair distributional effect, because even though they receive free allowances, companies, they move their, due to the higher cost, they move, they shift the effect on consumers, increasing the prices. And go to conclusion. Yeah. And so for what I read and what I understood from your paper, there are mainly there is one recommendation. First, we have to consider that the carbon tax will not be accepted by the European Commission. You said from ideological point of view, but even from technical point of view, because we need the support of all the 28 European member countries. So it's pretty impossible to achieve it. But as it is now, the ETS in this quantity system, it doesn't work in the moment in which there is a crisis and in the moment in which there is a fall of the prices. So the best option should be to maintain this system, but at the same time to set a price floor. In this way, if we will have a crisis and with a fall of the prices, this system will work. But at the same time, you said to implement the development complementary policy, and on this probably we'll have some question later.
So about the theoretical framework, when we analyze the environmental economics, this literature, they will focus on a set of instruments that will minimize the overall cost of achieving these prescribed environmental objectives, that in our case is to reduce pollution, CO2 emissions. So from this literature, and that professor already explained pretty detailed and probably better than we are going to explain, we can see that his argumentation is based on price systems versus quantity systems. And what are then the price, the quantity systems is what we see in the EU ETS, that you put a cap, as we see, a limit to the pollution, and then a set of allowances is distributed, as Davi already mentioned, and is followed by different phases that should be implemented. Inside this quantity system, we can see that the companies, they have a flexibility in which they can operate to decide where they will pollute and how they will pollute due to the internal marginal abatement costs. And the price system is the total polar different system compared to quantity system. And as we basically, as the professor basically said, we apply a tax to the carbon, to the pollution of carbon, and then this price is applied to all industries and all sectors inside the economy. But what is the main difference between these two systems? What we can see is that the set of policies to implement these two systems, they are overlapped. They need a firm regulation, then they need sectors that are really seeing what is happening between them two, especially when you say due to the allowances that are given, due to the taxes that are going to be practiced. And as we said, the ETS system, it only covers 45% of the total emissions. So it needs to be something that is really regulated. And as he also said, how you put a price on that and how you put the optimal quantity that is going to be sufficient inside the environment. So also the difference between them two, the main difference between them two, as I'm going to say now, is the price system that is inside them two. Inside the quantity system, the price fluctuates inside the market. So as we can see, this price decrease can impact a lot the implementation of the system due to if there is an urge to reduce pollution, because if the firms can buy this to a low cost, they won't think as hard to pollute as they would do if the price of these allowances were big. And also to invest in long-run innovative policies to change the way they are producing so they can produce less. And this is also an aim inside the quantity systems that we don't see too much inside the price systems. This push to implement innovative P&D technologies inside the market. So with due to these price differences in a responsiveness to a crisis context, the quantity system will respond in a worse way because the market will determine the price of the carbon, and the government in this context, and the professor already said, they need to have a good intervention, a high intervention inside the economy to stimulate the economic activity and also to put a floor on this carbon price so the market doesn't fluctuate by themselves. So the author's point of view is that due to the literature review, as he already mentioned also in his presentation, the literature showed that there is a better response for price systems than quantity system, and due to also the environmental and political environment that we can see inside the EU ETS is the EU ETS is not functioning 100%, and it needs a change to this structure in a way that is a short-term and effective effective new policy. But we, as we discuss it and we analyze in our naive point of view about the literature, we think that this political environment can happen also in price system and in quantity system in a way that in the allowances the government can choose the risky sectors, and also this could happen in the price systems also when they can apply different taxation to different sectors. So this political environment could happen in both ways, and we think that if also we agree that if a price to the carbon inside the quantity system would maybe give them the credibility that also the European Union says in their website, that is a way that companies will benefit if they pollute less in a way that they will get paid for the allowances that they are selling, or the companies that pollute more will pay for these extra allowances that they need to buy. And if there is a push to, if there is a floor to this price, maybe the lead to innovative technologies would be better in the long run and could achieve one of the aims of the policy. So the COP21, what is the COP21? Is the Conference of Parties, Paris Climate Summit, as an annual meeting. This is since 1995, that the 195 countries that are inside the United Nations, they get together to discuss the climate change. And why this time is so important, as we said that this happens every year and they set some targets and goals every year, why in 2015 this is an important meeting? So due to environmental changes that we can see in the world, and the temperature is rising faster than the scientists was expecting, and everybody can see, even the ones that don't believe so much in the climate change, they are having a response that maybe there is a change happening, and the countries are with some extra pressure to do something because of the what science is saying, and also due to some political changes in the world, new presidents that are becoming more environmental friendly. So there is also a political change, and as I'm going to say, then the biggest one is the agreement between the US and China last year to commit to reduce pollution, and they are the most polluters in the world. So this can show us something that there is a name to change things. And also in the last meetings, the chief of the states, they only get to these meetings like in the end, like in the last days, just to sign the agreement, but this time they will be in Paris since the beginning, participating in what's happening. So this also can show us that something is really going to change this year. So the agreement that they will sign, it will be agreement capable of keeping the average global temperature rise below 2 degrees Celsius compared to the pre-industrial levels. And also there is something that the developing countries already benefit from the emissions, and how this is going to condemn the new developing countries. And this agreement, it needs to be universal. All the countries need to assign ambitious, flexible balance between mitigation and adaptation, sustainable and dynamic. Really utopic, but we can see from the discussion before the meeting that something is about to change. And we want to know, like, what is the European Union role in this meeting? So we are going to ask the questions and know about.
The first question is mainly related with long run and innovation policies, and in this point of view, you said in the last part of your paper, we should implement a price floor and complementary development policy. So I would like to ask you, what are this kind of development and complementary policy in this framework and in the framework of try to create incentive for companies in order to create innovation in these terms, in terms of environmental economics?
And also, as we said, we can see that in the argumentation of the problems of the EU ETS, we see that the problems can happen in both quantity and price systems. And we can see that the political influence is probably the main one that is backing up the quantity system inside Europe. So how a political reform could be done in order to improve the existing system or create a better one, because as we saw, the price system couldn't be fully implemented because it needs unanimity inside Europe to sign fiscal rule and policies. And the third question, even with its flaws, the EU ETS system, it's considered a model in carbon emissions to the world. So how important is this inside the context of the coming COP21 to influence this world agreement, this utopic world agreement? Also analyzing that Europe has an political influence to the decisions and to new implemented models in other side of the world.
And the last question is a question for people as me, coming from option B, so financialization and financial markets, because it's not related with your paper, but reading, maybe because you are here, maybe you are the best person to ask about it. I've read that in terms of allowances, and now there is this market of allowances that is developing a secondary market, a financial market on the ETS and on this kind of allowances. If you can give us some outline on this kind of in this market, and if it's going to develop a financialization even of environment. Thank you.
Should I take some questions now?
Maybe, okay, so since we have four questions so far, maybe I'll take a couple of questions. Does anybody want to ask anything? No? Yeah, okay, so... Yeah, so maybe he can just answer the four first ones and then we go with the debate.
Okay. Thanks a lot for for your presentation, your discussion. I fully agree with what you said. Especially the fact that in it's true that in every carbon tax adopted or even discussed worldwide, there's been a differentiation of rates between exposed heavy industry and other actors, which is not optimal, but it's a political reality. So I will try to answer briefly your four questions. For the first one, I think the situation is very different between the electricity sector and heavy industry. In the electricity sector, well, we know that we need to decarbonize it completely, or almost completely. In 2050, the official target of the EU is minus 80 to minus 95%. There are three possible technologies proposed: renewables, or families of technologies, renewables, nuclear. I prefer to see them. CO2 capture and storage. I really think that the prospect for CO2 capture and storage in the electricity sector is in Europe is very low for various reasons, but one sufficient reason is it's much more expensive than renewables. For nuclear, I think that there are also very good reasons not to develop it. So basically, we know what should be done, and the development of renewable is taking place, too slowly, but is taking place with other policy instruments than the ETS, with the feed-in tariffs, for example. It's another debate what is the best instrument. But here, I think the solution is to go to pursue these existing instruments in addition to the ETS. For every industry, it's very different. We need really not only incremental innovations, but more fundamental changes in technologies, which depend on the sector, obviously. We know more or less what are the candidates in the steel sector, in the cement sector, and so on. But it's not the CO2 price that will allow these candidates to grow at the fast in, to grow fast enough. So we need R&D subsidies. One way to fund these subsidies is already going on inside the ETS. It's to set aside a part of the allowances, to sell these allowances, and to use the money for these subsidies. I think it's possibly a good way to do it. One problem is that with the quantity instrument, we don't know in advance the price, so we don't know in advance how many euros these 300 million allowances that have been set aside will deliver, and so we don't know in advance if it will be enough for these subsidies. Second question, well, the useful reform would be that fiscality be decided at under the qualified majority rule with co-decision and not the unanimity. I don't know if this answers your question, but...
For us, when we were reading the paper, the point was not the quantity system in itself, mm-hmm. but the procedure during time. In fact, if the you can see the thing from phase one to phase three. Phase one only for 29 sectors with free allowances, lobbying and due to lobbying activities.
Okay.
Now we have half of it that they have free allowances. So yeah, I think in the end it's not a quantity of price debate, but it's only political and only our struggle between European Union and
I think that the rules are not so bad in the. And I think the Commission has been really realistic. But because they decided to go for free allocation at the beginning in order so that the heavy industry would not kill the proposal and that it could pass. And I think they knew that it was not optimal, but they knew that it would ease the acceptability of the process. And if you take the US, the House of Representatives voted for an ETS in 2009, it was a Waxman-Markey bill, but the Senate did not, for various reasons, the power of the coal industry in the US especially, but they decided to go for auction allowances instead of free allowances, and maybe if they had given more to the industry, the proposal would have passed. I don't know, but it's a possibility. So political realism is very important for this kind of ambitious policies. Third point, yes, it's true that it has been considered a model. Also a model because of its flaws. And people in California and China have looked at the EUTS in detail, also in order not to replicate some of these mistakes. And But it points to a really important issue, that is, it's important for some countries to go forward with this kind of policies so that other countries will implement not exactly the same policies, but hopefully better policies. And this is a spillover. Remind that greenhouse gases are global pollutants, so it does not matter whether they are emitted in Europe or in China. And so if the EU ETS has speed up the implementation of ETS in China, it's a benefit from the ETS too. So I think it has been very important. But now, if you look at the Californian system, it's probably better designed than the ETS. The last point, it's probably the one I've worked on the least. I think there's been the European Commission has been a bit naive. You know the expression new converts are the more fanatics, something like that. I don't know in English how it's French. Nouveaux convertis sont toujours les plus fanatiques. remember that the Commission was against emission trading up to Kyoto, and now they have very ideological pro-trading statements. Two people who propose the price law, they say no, the government should not intervene in the market, which should set the price. No. Come on, it's the government which set up these markets anyway. So it's not a market created just by people outside of governments. So, and they allowed anybody to participate in the market, which made frauds and speculation easier. They could have limited participation to covered operators of covered emissions, to some financial institutions, and for example to NGOs wanting to cancel some allowances. This exists, you can pay NGOs to cancel allowances and reduce emissions. And this would have limited the role for fraud, which is not
exactly your question, but and also for financial innovations, I'm not a specialist, but it seems that they really did not analyze this enough, and it's not obvious if really there was a speculation on this market, and if to what extent this drove the evolution of prices. But it's it's a possibility, and well, I think that there was too much free market ideology from the people in charge of this in the commission. If you have one.
Thanks for the explanations. Does anybody have any questions now?
Questions. I have four questions. So first, I think that it was a choice for this seminar to focus more on what's going on now in the discussion in this trade system and all the issue about tax and cap. But the first, let's say, that basic question is about norms. Okay, we are talking about tax and cap, but we could also discuss about norms, which is another issue, which is also very important. The second aspect, what do you think? Is it on the table? Or don't we talk about norms? The second point is related also to some of the questions that have been raised, is about to what extent countries could decide to implement more ambitious policy. Okay, of course we can say in a very static point of view that there is a problem of competitiveness implementing other types of policies. But we can imagine that in a dynamic perspective it's a little bit different. First, because you can also rely partly on the consumer, you can put labels on your products, saying that it's okay, environmentally friendly things, but also you can develop new markets because you will have this more ambitious policy. For instance, if we take an example, which is a little bit related to the issue of norm, if the norm, for instance, which is not a norm for product, in Germany is to say that we don't have any more nuclear plants. That means also that we must innovate and develop the market, the products, and also sell abroad many products related to renewables. Which means that at the beginning in Germany, the emissions will increase, and sometimes increase a lot, but in a more long-run process, maybe it makes sense. So there is an issue of innovation, an issue of macroeconomic policy, an issue of geopolitical, an issue of really political will to develop another policy. So to what extent countries can choose, depending on also maybe on developing or developed countries, to what extent they could implement another policy. And the third question, and my fourth question will come here, the third question is about the political will of this country. So it was really impressive in Germany that they decided to stop the nuclear industry while they were a country associated with France involved in this policy. It was just after Fukushima, but it was a surprise that Angela Merkel decided to change policy. When we look at what will happen in the next weeks at the COP21, lots of movements in favor of fighting against climate change organized many demonstrations and things in order to push the government to decide something for the climate. And a little bit surprisingly, because we had some terrorist attacks in last January with a very, very huge demonstration with more than 4 million people in the street. Strangely, now we decide just to prevent all these organizations to demonstrate. So is it just a matter of security, or is there any lack of political will to change things on time? So how do you feel this is?
Okay. So from the beginning, to answer your question, yes, CTS covers emissions in the EU only. So if a company has plants abroad, these emissions are not covered. And this raises what's called the issue of carbon leakage, that is the possibility that by raising the CO2 price in Europe, we increase emissions elsewhere in the world. I've worked a lot on this topic, and especially with colleagues, we've tried to quantify it
in the two main sectors by emissions, which are steel and cement, and to see if the CO2 price has led to a rise in net imports of steel and cement into the EU. So our answer is no, at least in the short run. That is, operators did not use plants abroad more because of the CO2 price in Europe. We cannot say yet that this does not happen in the long run. That is, that there would be more investments in this kind of plants abroad than in Europe because of the CO2 price. But then, in the long run, we have to realize that the EU is not alone in having a CO2 price. There is an ETS in Korea. There will soon be an ETS in China, nationwide. There are ETS in North America too. And so, if you in this industry, the new investment takes years for decades. So it's I really don't think that now there is really a risk of carbon leakage because of climate policies. And you said that it's a global problem, so we should not tackle it regionally, but there is no alternative. There is no global government. There is no possibility for governments to agree on policies, on domestic policies, on policies which would specify what to do with this kind of plans, for example. There's been discussions about sectoral agreements for years, which have not led to many things. So it's not perfect, but there is no alternative. It's not completely true, but I mean, without global agreements specifying policies applying to these sectors, we have to choose regional policies or national policies. About other application to other contexts, for water, yes, there's a long history of trading of rights to for water. But I'm really not a specialist, but it exists in various countries. There's also markets for rights to catch fish in various places, sometimes with tradable rights. I don't think so for the other examples for the other environmental policies that you've mentioned. And but one big problem, especially for air pollution or water pollution, is that the location matters. Greenhouse gases are well-mixed pollutants, so it does not matter whether CO2 is emitted in China or Europe. For SO2 or NOx, it matters, because it does not generate the same damage. For reforms, so the reforms for the ETS, yes, will be implemented only in 2019, so it's late. Because we know the problem of the surplus since 2009, so 10 years to start solving the problem is a long time, and so it's clearly a problem. It's due to partly to the decision-making rules in Europe that are complex, partly to the fact that some governments do not want any climate policies at all, especially you take Poland, because they rely heavily on coal. But it's exactly the same problem as in the US, where coal states are really stand up on the brakes against climate policies, and the Republicans and Democrats alike. And so, this generates the difficult question. Should we implement national policies covering the same emissions as the emissions covered by the EU ETS or not? In the UK, they've implemented a price floor, that is, they tax emissions from their power plants, but domestically. But then it
it has a perverse impact that it reduces further the CO2 price, so it increases emissions elsewhere, but it's the same for the other domestic policies. There is no easy answer. I hope that I answered your question. Now, norms. Regulations exist for CO2 emissions outside, and are very important for CO2 emissions outside the ETS. In cars, but we've recently seen how easy it was to cheat, well, at least in the EU. But this kind of cheating appeared in other contexts. And for example, for electricity consumption of fridges. well, but even if we know that there is some cheating, I'm convinced that this kind of regulation is extremely important. Now, our regulations for boilers have been implemented in Europe. There are regulations on every energy-related product, either adopted or soon, or that will soon be adopted, from windows to fridge freezers to washing machines and so on. And it's very good. Of course, if the monitoring was better, it would be even better. Now, for the sectors covered by the ETS, there are proposals to have an emission performance standard for power plants. I think that it can be a second best to having CO2 pricing. Still, I think that it cannot be perfect, and that we still need CO2 pricing, either in the form of tax or in ETS. Why? First, because you have many different processes. You have plants with a different history. How can you put the same norm to a brand new plant and to a plant which is 30 years old? It's difficult. And second, norms are generally expressed not as ton of CO2 per year, but as at best as ton of CO2 per unit produced. For example, per ton of cement. Okay, so you could put this kind of norms, but then it does not create an incentive to reduce the production of polluting products. And the same problem with subsidies. So you use one lever to reduce emissions, so you reduce the emissions per unit produced, but then you don't use the second lever, which is reducing the production of polluting products, for example, cement, and using more wood in construction, for example. For that, you have to raise also the price of cement. And for that, you need CO2 pricing in one form or another. Your second question was, to what extent countries implement more ambitious policies? I think to a large extent. If you look at Sweden, they have a CO2 tax at more the equivalent of more than 100 euros a ton of CO2. If you compare to the 8 euros per ton of CO2 in the EU ETS, it's much, much higher. It does not apply to every emission. It does not apply to industry. So in heavy industry, for products that are traded internationally, there are some limits if you don't want your plants to close and carbon leakage. Okay. Otherwise, and even then, there are some mitigation measures. I have not also worked on this, like border adjustments, well, which are not always feasible, but there are ways to deal with that. So I think that it can be done. So the problem is really only political. And it's the fact that in many countries, mitigating climate change implies to change the situation in industries with a very high political power. It's more the case in countries with a coal industry, but it's the case almost everywhere, because if you take the case of France, I've shown you how they did their allocation plan. But at that time, the minister in charge of finance was a former CEO of Arcelor, so the main steel producer. So no surprise that they took a decision which was really very good for the French steel industry. And these industries are powerful in most countries. Probably with time, they will be less and less powerful, but it will take time. And especially if you look at the position taken by the umbrella organization of firms like MEDEF in France, on these topics, they really, of course, it's umbrella organizations that have that gather firms that have completely opposing interests in many respects. But on these topics, who do they listen to heavy industry and electricity sector? And who do they send to negotiation? People from electricity or gas or oil companies or heavy industry, always. So it's not easy to go forward. I was impressed too by the nuclear decision to phase out nuclear in Germany. If you are in France, it seems that it's just impossible to close a single nuclear power station, and even in 5 years, and even in a situation when half of the people working, of EDF people working in nuclear power station, will retire in the next years. In Germany, they close 7 or 8 power plants from one day to the other, and just do it like that. but for coal, they are much less willing to do it, even though their coal mines will close in a few years, but not their lignite mines. So how to do it? I think, well, it's for this problem as for other problems. What is needed is the mobilization of people, not just in opinion polls, but also in the street, through mobilization, showing that people really care about climate change, and that it is something that people will take into account when they vote. Or simply, for the moment, more politicians think that, even though people would like, maybe most people would like more action against climate change, but they will not change their vote according to this issue. It's a minor issue, like foreign policy and so on. So maybe, I hope it will change. Maybe it starts to change in some countries, but it's really the way to, it's really a necessity. And because even if 90% of people think that we should do more about climate change, if the last 5% are working in the coal industry or in an industry related to climate change, and if it's very important for them, this 5% of people will have more influence than the 95%, because it's not a referendum for or against the climate policy, it's an election. And if the 95% vote for other things, they count less. Finally, about the demonstration, it's very sad for the people, some of them I know very well, who have been organizing these demonstrations for a very long time. I really don't think that the government was especially afraid of this demonstration, and that they're just taking the security issue as a kind of excuse to cancel them, especially because the coalition Climat 21, that has been gathered that's not a very specific motto, because they wanted to include
many people, including the CGT, so they don't, voilà, so, no, I wouldn't say so.
Any more questions?
Hi, I had two questions. First, we talked briefly about the potential for speculation on the market for ETS. I'm wondering if there's a potential there for private groups to try to deliberately bid up the price of these permits to try to artificially lower the cap as far as if the EU won't take action, maybe a couple billionaires get together and create an organization to try to raise money to buy these things and withhold them from the market. It just seems like an interesting way to get around a lot of the political problems of the EU. And then the second question, I was wondering if you could just talk a little more about COP21 and sort of what we should expect as far as listening to it day by day, and what sort of the best case scenario we could realistically expect to get out of this would be.
Thanks. More questions? Okay.
Yeah. My last question is just to enlarge also the debates, because one thing that we could not talk is about other scenarios, and I know that you know, for instance, the gigawatt scenario, which is a scenario defined by an NGO, aiming to really define a very precise and interesting scenario, so that in 2030, I think, we meet the objectives in terms of gas emission. We also stop all the nuclear plants by 2030. It's a scenario for France. And so discussing, studying really the primary energy, secondary energy, everything, all the links, also now the links between the energy sector, the other sector, the agriculture, and it has also impacts, possible impacts on employment. I think you worked on employment, so job creation, etc., etc. So there are some other scenarios that are really, really different from what is on the table now. So maybe you could say a few words about this type of scenario, and if someone is interested here, what they could read or at least give the philosophy of this scenario.
I also would like to know, from what you just you and my colleagues talked about before, that these measures maybe shouldn't be regional but global. What would be the impact of implementing a global cap, for instance, or a global tax for countries? Since, for instance, nowadays developing countries, they don't really have the requirement to achieve some levels as developed countries do. And if that would create, for instance, more inequalities between developed and developing countries. No.
Yes, I have two questions and a remark. My first question is, a few months ago, the Dutch state was sentenced to act against climate change. So I was wondering, what does that mean exactly in terms of effective policies? And do you think that would be an effective mean to reverse the balance of power, so to force the state to act against climate change? My second question is, depending on the kind of data you look at, in 2010, France imported 30% to 45% to the CO2 it consumes. It means that almost from one third to one half of the CO2 induced by French consumption was actually coming from abroad. So do you think that implementing some kind of CO2 tariff at the European Union borders would be an effective way to force, to some extent, trading partners to curb their emissions? And I just had a remark for the discutant. You said that the United States and China had an agreement to decrease the pollution or CO2 emission. Actually, I think it's not totally true. First of all, because China did not commit to decrease CO2 emission, but committed to decrease the CO2 intensity of GDP, which means that CO2 emissions will continue to rise by 2030. And also, they took as a base year 2005 and not 1990, which makes a huge difference in the mitigation of emissions.
What we read about in the COP21 website is that in Copenhagen 2009 and Cancun 2010, it was committed by the developing countries to set a fund of $100 billion per year by 2020 to help developing countries to cope with the climate change and also help them with this new commitment in reductions. So in a post-crisis remain scenario, if you think this is still possible to do, if they are doing it, because they say that this is a huge backup for developing countries agree to sign what probably will be signed, hoping that they will be backed up by this fund that can help us cope with these changes. So what do you think, if this is possible, if they will really do it, and in what extent this could be really possible to help these developing countries?
So your first question was about the possibility of speculation, and more precisely the fact that some participant could have pushed the price up or down, depends. This is what I was mentioning when I briefly talked about market power in the emission market. It's well known that if one participant is has a high share of the market, it has an interest either or to raise the price or to decrease the price, depending on whether he's a buyer or a seller. This is compounded by the fact that if this firm has a dominant position both in the emission market and in the output market, it can try to raise the CO2 price in order to exclude some participants from the output market, like the electricity market. So this kind of thing is has been studied in theory. It has existed in other kind of markets, like the market for renewable energy certificates in Belgium. For CO2, I haven't seen evidence yet. There are a lot of plants covered, more than 10,000. It does not mean 10,000 firms. It means we don't know exactly the number of firms. But if you take to have 3/4 of the market, you need, I'm not sure to remember, I think 100 companies. So it cannot be excluded. But I haven't seen evidence of this behavior. But definitely, this is another advantage for a tax compared to an emission trading system. So there cannot be this kind of price manipulation. The second question was what to expect from COP21. I'm really not following international negotiations anymore. I did it closely some time ago. But people have to realize that these agreements are tools, are only tools for people in their countries to win some political battles. Even Kyoto, which is
according to lawyers, legally binding. Look at what Canada did. Canada had a commitment which it was really not going to fulfill. Emissions were rising, while their commitment was to decrease emissions, I think, by 6 or 7% compared to 1990. What did there's been a political change, and what did the conservative government do? They decided to withdraw from the Kyoto Protocol. And what happened to Canada? Absolutely nothing. So even for legally binding, so-called legally binding agreement, nothing happened. So for the kind of weaker commitments that we will see in the COP, the legally binding nature of which is completely unclear if you have listened to John Kerry versus other people recently. It's people will have commitment, country will have presented commitments. This commitment will be used by groups defending climate policies, and it's very important. Without the Kyoto commitments, we would not have had many of the policies we've had, for example, to support renewable policies. But don't expect more than that. And the paradox is that Copenhagen is presented as a failure. Paris will be presented as a success. Well, this is what I've been saying for 1 year. So the storytelling will be extremely different, but the nature of the agreement will not. This is at least my guess, my bet. About the other scenarios. There are energy scenarios designed by governmental agencies for years, at least since the first oil shocks and probably even before. And I think that they are not the most the most interesting scenarios. They are not the most transparent scenarios, and not the most interesting. And scenarios designed by some NGOs, like the Negawatt scenario, are more both more transparent and more interesting because they show a technically possible way of solving the climate problem, at least the contribution by France to the climate problem. And it's more transparent because it's expressed only in physical terms. But it specifies what is really important, the square meters of buildings, the passenger kilometers or ton kilometers for transport, and so on a yearly basis. and it's done partly by people who are professionally engaged in energy transition because they are working, for example, on low energy buildings. And this kind of scenarios exist also in other countries. It's a bit of a paradox, by the way, that in France, NGO does this scenario and not researchers, not. Maybe it's due to the fact that in France, most of the energy economists are working for the big energy companies. But it's just a guess, like EDF, ENGIE, and Total. It's not only in France, but I think that in Germany, for example, there are more diversity, and also there's a room in Germany for consulting firms that are at the same, well, some kind of think tanks that are between a consulting firm, an NGO, or a research institute, like the Eco Institute, the Wuppertal Institute. There's very few such institutions in France, And I think that for this kind of work, they are very useful. Global tax, about the Tyrol proposal of a global tax. I don't remember who. Yeah, you raised the question. I was a bit really surprised to read that or to listen to this proposal by Gaudian Tyrol, not by the proposal itself because it's not new. It was proposed in the 90s already, and it was written in the report by Jean Tyrol a few years ago. Now, what surprised me was to propose this in the context of the COP21, as if it could be included in an agreement, which is completely unrealistic. Completely. I mean, at the beginning of the negotiations, this idea of global price was proposed, was analyzed. Well, it's logical that economists make proposals that are cannot be implemented in the next years, and it's a good thing because otherwise you get trapped in the political realities and there is no room to improve things. But presenting this as a concrete alternative, as a feasible alternative, I really don't understand. But first, is it good? Would it be good to have this global tax? What does pure economic theory say? It says it's good to have a unique CO2 price if there are adequate transfers between rich and poor, winners and losers from the climate policy, and if this price is not only a price paid by the country, but a price paid by every emitter. If there is not these transfers, or if the CO2 price agreed to at the global level is not decentralized for every emitter, then there is no economic argument for that. And both conditions are impossible to realize. It's just impossible to imagine that the US Senate will agree to have an automatic transfer from the US to every country that emits a lower amount of CO2, like Syria, Iraq, or any what they call the rogue states. It's just completely impossible. And if you look at the Kyoto Protocol, in theory, if you remember, there is emission trading among countries. Did countries trade emissions among each other? Almost not. Canada could have bought spare emissions from Russia. They did not want to. They did not want just to give a check to Russia just to fulfill an agreement. This is something that just cannot happen like that. So the idea of a global, and I'm really convinced that we need CO2 pricing. But CO2 pricing at the international level, it could make its way in the following manner. First, we have to recognize that there are very different CO2 prices, with the top one is probably in Sweden, or more than 100 euros a ton of CO2. But there are massive negative pricing of CO2 because there are massive subsidies to fossil fuels. In rich countries, it's rather subsidies to exploration. In poor countries, it's rather, in some poor, or not too poor, but some developing countries, subsidies to consumption, like in Venezuela, Iran, also Russia. But what does it mean to have a global CO2 price when you have massive subsidies to fossil fuel at the same time? The real CO2 price is just not equalized, and so you don't have the case for economic efficiency. So if you want to go toward some convergence of the CO2 price, the first step would be to phase out subsidies to CO2 emissions. So there, this is discussed at the OECD, at the World Bank, at the G20 every year, with really mixed results. I think that economists focusing on economic efficiency should first focus on this. First, phase out CO2 subsidies to CO2 emissions. And then, in some countries, try to get CO2 pricing. But the idea is that everybody in the world can pay 100 euros a ton of CO2, doesn't make much sense. If you take small farmers in Senegal, they have cows emit methane. Methane is a very potent CO2 gas. If they make them pay 100 euros per ton of CO2 equivalent, they just die. So you can try to imagine transfer so that they will not, but it's extremely difficult to do that. For the Netherlands, the Dutch government, I must admit, I was extremely, I'm not a lawyer, and I was really surprised to read this news. And I know that many groups worldwide are trying to replicate this kind of court case. But I really have no, I must admit, I have really no knowledge of the possibility to have this kind of court case elsewhere in the world. And what will happen in the Netherlands based on this judgment, I don't know. But CO2 imported by France. This is definitely an important problem. I think I was one of the first in France among economists to work on carbon tariffs. It's probably true that if you try to quantify the amount of CO2 generated by the production of the goods and services that we use in France, you end up with more than the emissions in the French territory. But it's to get a precise number, you really need heuristic assumptions. You need to use national accounting and with worldwide input-output tables. and it's you need assumptions that go far, far below above what you need to compute emissions on a territory. And so you have to be very cautious. And if you compare the various quantifications that have been made for a single country in a single year, you have huge, huge discrepancies. So I don't think that we can base an international agreement or commitments on this kind of data in the next years or even in the next decades. This being said, we have to think of policies to reduce these emissions too. But when you look at more precisely where do these 30% of extra emissions come from, they don't come from CO2 intensive products directly. It's not so much the imports of cement or steel or aluminium. It's rather the steel products for which the cost of CO2 is much lower than the cost of labor. And it's more consumption goods, which we import massively more than we export them. So these embedded emissions are not due to the climate policies, and so it's not easy to correct them through a CO2 tariff, I think, from what I've seen for Europe. It may be different in other countries. And second part of the answer, the main country which has an lower emissions based on consumption than on territorial emissions. It's China. And China, I'm convinced, will soon have a national ETS. About the Green Fund and the $100 billion. Is it still possible? I think it was always difficult. It's politically necessary to have every country or almost every country on board because it's a promise. It will not be $100 billion public money. So our governments, including the French government, will try to put some private money in this basket and pretending that it's extra money while it will sometimes not be. and so there will be harsh debates. There will be hopefully some compromise about what can be counted for this $100 billion, and I hope it will arrive at a kind of compromise. And then the other important question is how to spend this money. It's also extremely difficult. How to fund adaptation? On paper, it's easy, but when you look at concrete projects, you realize that the projects that make sense in general are not completely specific to climate change, because you need to be adapted to your climate. A climate, you know, is a distribution of weather. And so to be better adapted to a new climate means being also better adapted to your current climate in the worst years. This is a general rule. For example, you will have to be to in some countries you will need to be adapted to more rain or less rain, but you have already droughts, you have already inundations some years. And so what do you count as adaptation to climate change? What do you count as adaptation to the current climate? It's very difficult to separate things. But this is an extremely important topic for research too.
Thank you very much for coming.